Apple Card is the perfect credit card for every purchase. It has cashback rewards unlike others. You earn unlimited daily cashback on every purchase. Receive it daily and can grow it at 4.15% annual percentage yield when you open a high-yield savings account. Apply for Apple Card in the Wallet app on iPhone and start earning and growing your daily cash with savings today. Apple Card subject to credit approval. Savings is available to Apple Card owners subject to eligibility requirements. Savings accounts provided by Goldman Sachs Bank USA. Member FDIC. Terms apply.
Here's your money briefing for Friday, September 1st. I'm J.R. Whalen for the Wall
Street. Take the next right onto North D Street, then turn right onto Gordon Avenue.
Free Journal. More and more workers are getting the call that their company is going through some staffing changes. But they're not losing their job. Instead, they're being reassigned.
It's a range of emotions. The people that I talk...
Take the next right onto Gordon Avenue, then turn left onto North D Street.
Who said they had everything from relief that at least they weren't laid off and they still had a job, to anger. They were just angry that they had no say in where they were going and what they were being told to do, basically told to do or else.
We'll talk with our reporter, Racer.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto North B Street.
About this current trend in corporate America. Call it quiet cutting. That's after the break.
Take the next left onto Rhea Avenue.
We all know a been there, done that person. You know, the one who thinks that they've been everywhere.
In 1,000 feet, turn right onto North B Street.
Not everything. To them, we say, meet your match. Ontario, Canada. The place with a list of places to be and things to do so long that even the most been there, done that of people have yet to have been there and, well...
Take the next right onto North B Street.
Done that. From eating at a Michelin-starred restaurant, to letting out your inner high roller, to one of the largest Oktoberfest celebrations outside of Germany. To be here, do that. Go to destination on...
Continue for 8 miles.
Ontario.com/visit.
As many companies re-examine their staffing, the good news is they're not laying off employees, but the bad news is they're offering workers a chance to stay, but reassigning them to less than ideal positions. Wall Street Journal reporter Ray Smith joins me. So, Ray, first of all, what do we mean by reassigning employees?
It basically means alerting an employee that their old role has been eliminated and that they will now be moved into a different role, one that's not of their choosing, and if they don't take the reassignment, they don't have any option but to leave.
So it sounds like the employees don't have much say in this.
They don't have any say in it except to whether they are taking the assignment or they are declining it. And if they're declining it, they don't have another job offer.
Now, this idea of reassigning employees, is this something new?
It's not something new. Involuntary reassignments have been a way for companies to move people, for instance, to growing parts of the business from slower growing parts of the business. It's happening now in large part because of the uncertain economy, and businesses are really trying to cut costs. And if they turn to layoffs, they have to pay severance costs. So that's a big expense. It could be thousands of dollars per person. And so reassigning people is a way to save on having to pay those severance costs. Businesses are also trying to retain people as well if they're putting them in other spots, because it costs them more to hire somebody and train them and onboard them. Some of this is due to the changing labor market as well. The job market is still relatively tight, but not as tight as it was a year or two ago. And so for some of these employees, they're staying put because they really are nervous that they won't be able to find a new job as quickly, and companies know this.
So how are workers being affected by this? By not being fired, but then being boxed into a role they might not like?
As you can imagine, it's probably, you know, it's a range of emotions. The people that I talked to said they had everything from relief that at least they weren't laid off and they still had a job, to anger. They were just angry that they had no say in where they were going and what they were being told to do, basically told to do or else. Some people had dread that the company was sort of sending them some kind of message about what they truly think of them. People said it took a toll on their mental health even. There's confusion because sometimes people are thrown into roles where they don't even have the kind of expertise that role requires, but they're expected to sort of sink or swim, and they end up floundering. So it can really do a number on one's self-esteem. You know, some people do accept it, and they're grateful to still be employed, and they also figure maybe there's another job I can find at the company if I stay long enough. I don't have to do this forever, so maybe I'll find another job within the company. So some hang on in the hopes that they can find something else.
Yeah, so a lot of stuff going through people's minds. When this scenario comes up, are there signs that they could look for regarding the motive behind what the company has in mind?
Some signs that people should look out for include a reassignment that is basically a demotion. It's a job that is far below the pay or skill level that you currently have. Another is being offered a role that requires relocating when your boss knows moving really isn't a real option for you. Another sign is being reassigned to a division that's rumored to be on the chopping block. So those are just some things to look out for.
But if the employee could be uneasy with this, is the company at risk of losing the worker if that person is unhappy with the new job, or if they feel it might not be a good fit with their career?
Absolutely, they are at risk of that. But some companies' attitude is, we're willing to take that risk, we're willing to accept that some people will not agree to this and will leave. They're almost counting on it, although no companies will say that publicly. But they're ready for that, they're prepared for that.
But I guess at the same time, this could be a way for somebody to diversify their skills and their input to the company.
Absolutely, and some people view it that way. They unexpectedly find they like the role and they're learning new skills, and it could take them on a completely different career path.
Now, you spoke to several career professionals. What questions do they suggest that employees ask their manager if a reassignment is put on the table?
Yeah, this is really tricky because you really hope that you have a manager that can be pretty candid with you. But we were told that maybe you should try to get some feeling about like why this reassignment is happening and also what the reassignment means for their career path. And so you're trying to find out if this is really, you know, nothing personal, because otherwise you can go down a rabbit hole of paranoia. You just want to sort of ask questions that sort of say, how will this affect my career path?
That's Wall Street Journal reporter Ray Smith. And that's it for your Money Briefing. Today's show was produced by Ariana Osborne. I'm your host, J.R. Whalen. Our supervising producer is Melanie Roy. Aisha Al-Muslim is our development producer. Scott Salloway and Chris Zinsley are our deputy editors. And Falana Patterson is the Wall Street Journal's head of news audio. We'll be off on Monday for Labor Day, but we'll be back with a new show on Tuesday morning. Thanks for listening.
Support for NPR and the following message come from Arctic Wolf, dedicated to helping organizations end cyber risk with security operation solutions that monitor, detect, respond, and recover from cyber attacks whenever and wherever they strike. More at arcticwolf.com/NPR. You're listening to Shortwave from NPR.
When I was growing up, I was allergic to dairy. If I had a pizza or a bowl of cereal or ice cream, my nose would get totally stuffed up. In the scheme of things, though, it was just a mild allergy.
There are other people that will describe like a sense of doom, almost, that kind of comes over them.
This is Wahida Salmon, the director of clinical research at Northwestern University's Center for Food Allergy and Asthma Research.
Like the throat closing can definitely feel like they're breathing out of a straw. I can't take a deep breath. And then the itching and the swelling kind of comes on very immediately. Nausea and vomiting are very common in all age groups as well, just because it's like your body's trying to purge something that did not stay well with it. So it is a very wide range of experiences, but I think those who have extreme reactions describe it as just kind of like a whole body takeover.
People can be allergic to all sorts of things, from bee stings to medicines. But Wahida's specialty is food allergies, and their prevalence is exploding.
We call it an epidemic because it really has risen dramatically over the last few decades. So before the 1990s, the rate of food allergies in the U.S. amongst everyone was below 3%, maybe 2.5%. And just in children alone, research studies have found a dramatic increase over that time. Now we look at 1 in 13 children have a food allergy.
That means allergy rates have basically doubled. The strange thing is, this rise in allergies is not happening equally across the globe.
The rise has definitely occurred in America, Western Europe, Australia, and then parts of Asia and Africa. But no, there are definitely still places in the world where no one has a food allergy, no one's heard of food allergies. It's a very different experience. Huh. Yeah. And, you know, interestingly enough, what people are allergic to is also very different. So that varies globally as well. But no, food allergies are definitely on the rise in certain countries, but not others.
And do we know why?
That is the million-dollar question, right? We have a lot of theories. Some of them are backed with significant amount of research. Some are just emerging theories that people are trying to piece together.
So today on the show, we try to answer that million-dollar question. One theory, you absorb the food through your skin before you eat it, and then your body decides it is something to attack. Plus, we find out what food allergies are, how they differ around the world, and why only some people develop them. I'm Aaron Scott. You're listening to Shortwave, the science podcast from NPR.
This message comes from NPR sponsor 20th Century Studios, New Regency, and Entertainment One, presenting the creator from the visionary director of Rogue One. Amidst a future war between humans and the forces of artificial intelligence, a hardened ex-soldier is recruited to hunt down the creator, the elusive architect of advanced AI, who has developed a mysterious weapon with the power to end the war and mankind itself. Experience the movie event only in theaters September 29th, rated PG-13. This message comes from NPR sponsor USPS. Every business seeks an advantage, from having the best location to spotting trends before they happen. And now, the United States Postal Service can give your business a new advantage. Introducing USPS Ground Advantage, reliable and affordable 2 to 5 day package shipping. It's the advantage you need. Get the Ground Advantage at usps.com/advantage. The United States Postal Service, delivering for America.
So, Wahida, when somebody experiences an allergic reaction to food, will you zoom us in on what is happening on a biological and even a molecular scale?
So, the food, you know, goes into your stomach, it comes into your intestine, that food gets broken down to its basic proteins, and then it gets absorbed into your intestine. Along the intestinal lining, we've got tons and tons of immune cells, and one of those immune cells recognizes one of those foods because it's been previously programmed to label this food as something bad, and it sets off signals. We call them cytokines, but just chemicals that just go through your body, and it's like fight, fight, fight. It's basically telling your body, an invader has come, we have to fight. And so that sets off multiple different cascades throughout the body. And some of it is to fight the invader, and some of these symptoms that you're having are just secondary to the inflammation that the body is creating in order to fight this food that it's labeled as bad for you. So the swelling, for example, that you get in your throat when people have a very severe reaction, that's not really trying to fight anything. That's just secondary to the amount of inflammation your body has. One of the products of these chemical cascades is histamine, and that's why you get itchy, and that's why you get hives.
And so what sort of tools do we then have to treat these reactions, and what are they doing?
In a quarter mile, turn left onto the US 27 South, Ohio 126 East ramp to Cincinnati.
On a molecular level.
So that really depends on the type of reaction you have. There are some reactions that are very mild. You have some swollen lips, you have a little bit of itching, you have some hives or a rash. That can actually just be treated with antihistamines.
Turn left onto the US 27 South ramp.
And those will kind of stop those uncomfortable symptoms and kind of make the reaction go away. But if you have more severe symptoms, we really can't treat a severe reaction with just an antihistamine.
Continue on US 27 South for 5 miles.
So I'm talking about vomiting. If you're having any trouble breathing, your tongue is swelling, or your throat feels like it's swelling. If you feel faint, these are all very, you know, indicative of more severe reaction. And that would require a medication called epinephrine, which is essentially adrenaline.
So it will open up your airways. It will raise your blood pressure by constricting your blood vessels. The other interesting thing about epinephrine is that it will attach to some of those immune cells and stop the progression of an allergic reaction. But the way that epinephrine is given is through an injection. And that seems to be, you know, a hurdle for some folks who have food allergy. When you're in a severe reaction, nothing else is really going to take away the reaction or stop it from progressing the way epinephrine would.
Okay, so Wahida, you're saying that in an allergic reaction, the body misidentifies a protein in a food as something that is bad, and then it goes into attack. Can you tell us how this differs from a food intolerance? I mean, this is something I encountered all the time growing up. I'm allergic to dairy, and everyone would be like, oh, you're lactose intolerant. And I'm like, no. They are different things.
Yes, absolutely. That's a great point, because we see a lot of that. And we often try to advocate for the people who are truly, you know, allergic to dairy, because that's a very different set of circumstances and very different types of precautions than someone who is lactose intolerant. So lactose intolerance, for example, you don't have the enzymes to digest or enough of the enzymes to digest dairy products well, so they cause stomach upset and diarrhea and things like that. They will not make you, you know, have an allergic reaction. You will not get hives. Oftentimes people who have lactose intolerance will feel that hours later. People who have, you know, gluten sensitivity or, you know, celiac disease will have, you know, symptoms that kind of wax and wane. They're very different.
What do we know about why some people develop these food allergies while most people do not?
So what we do know is specifically in children that some children are at a very high risk, and one of the first signs that a child might be at high risk for developing a food allergy is that they have eczema. The earlier you develop eczema and the more severe the eczema is, the higher the risk of developing a food allergy. We think that there's a couple of reasons for that. One is, you know, eczema in and of itself is an allergic disorder. So when you're starting to have an allergic disorder very early in life, it kind of signals that certain things in the immune system are a little imbalanced. So some people feel, and there have been studies that should look at children with eczema and how different their gut flora is compared to children without, and there are significant differences. So these bacteria that have lived in our intestines for thousands and thousands of years, we feel like those have changed dramatically in the last 30 or 40 years because of what we're eating, what we're exposed to. Certain species have become more dominant. And all of those microbes that live in our gut, they talk to our immune system. And so they might be kind of pushing things towards more of an allergic route. And then if we talk a little bit about one of the other major theories of why we think children are getting food allergies, is that mislabeling that we talk about with food allergies. We feel very strongly that if you have a disrupted skin barrier and food particles are getting in through the skin, there have been really eloquent studies testing, you know, if you eat peanut butter in the house, do you have peanut in the dust in your house? Yes, you do. There's peanut particles everywhere. So definitely food can get into a broken skin barrier. And when it does, you know, your skin is an organ. Your skin has a very vital role in protecting you. So all those immune cells that live in your skin, they're ready to fight any sort of invader. And if they're getting a lot of food proteins, they might label those food proteins as something bad and something the body has to fight. So that means the next time you're exposed to it, you're going to have a reaction.
How do food allergies differ around the world, especially something with, like, peanuts, where it's present some places, not elsewhere, even within countries?
So we know that within the United States, for example, food allergies will differ for different races and different parts geographically. It's not dramatically different, but there are some differences. Globally, for example, different countries will have different types of allergic foods. So in the US, you know, peanut is definitely high, egg, cow's milk, tree nuts, and then sesame has become common, wheat, fish, and shellfish. If you go to other countries, for example, in India, lentil allergy.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto the I-275 west ramp to I-74, Indianapolis.
Allergies are common. Chickpea allergies are common. Not, again, India has far less food allergy than we do, but when they do have food allergy, it's to different foods. If you go to East Asia, they'll have different types of shellfish and fish that they'll report allergies to.
Turn right onto the I-275 west ramp.
And so it definitely does vary. There's also thoughts about how we process our food. So, you know, the big question is, like, why? Why peanut?
Right, because peanuts are...
In a quarter mile, merge onto I-275 west.
leading allergen.
Yeah, and it's a hard one to know. Like, I can't tell you I know the exact answer, but there have been studies that looked at how we manufacture peanuts now. So historically in other countries, peanuts are broiled. Here they are roasted. And we do think that the roasting process itself makes peanuts, those proteins, just a little bit more likely to kind of set off.
Continue on I-275 west for 8 miles.
Allergy as opposed to boiled peanuts, which people are eating in other countries.
So if someone thinks they have an issue with the food, what should they do? Where do they start?
Yeah, and I love that you're asking this question, because there are so many people that think they have one of these, you know, immediate type of reactions, and they don't. But they've been avoiding, like, large groups of foods. And some of these foods are just phenomenal sources of protein. And so what I would really recommend, and I know that there are definitely access to care issues, so I say this with some sensitivity, we really should try to find a healthcare provider that can help you get tested and at least be able to listen to what your symptoms are. Sometimes you don't even really need tests. You can tell someone what your symptoms are and they can tell you, okay, these are not consistent with one of these immediate type reactions. Or there's also certain foods that can just kind of lead to histamine release, but they're not actually food allergies. You don't have to carry an epinephrine pen or, you know, some sort of injector with you. They're not those types, and they will go away. There's other people who have allergies to things like pollen, and when those pollens are on the foods, they can have little bits of reaction. So there's so many different things that could probably free you of thinking you have one of these severe, you know, immediate types of reactions, and you can kind of walk freely knowing that you don't have them, and kind of go about your day, and also understand what kind of allergy you do have and what to do about it.
Well, Wahida Samadi, it's been a joy talking with you. Thank you for taking time today.
Thank you, Aaron. Thank you for your interest.
Before I head out, I want to thank the Shortwave Plus listeners. By subscribing, you're supporting our show and making it possible to answer questions like, where do allergies come from? And if you're a regular listener, we'd love for you to join so you can also enjoy the show without sponsor interruptions. You are our community. We cannot do this without you. Find out more at plus.npr.org/shortwave. This episode was produced by Burley McCoy, edited by our managing producer, Rebecca Ramirez, and fact-checked by Anil Ozon. Anil, we are delighted to have you back with us for a bit. The audio engineer was Robert Rodriguez. Beth Donovan is our senior director, and Anya Grundemann is our senior vice president of programming. I'm Aaron Scott. Thanks for listening to Shortwave from NPR.
Want to learn how to be a master of business without going back to school? This summer, enroll in the Planet Money Podcast MBA. Join classic Planet Money stories about the fundamentals of business, and then we'll break down the concepts, whether you want to start your own side hustle or just survive in your job. A little business know-how will make you richer, at least in knowledge. Every Wednesday till Labor Day on Planet Money from NPR.
This message comes from NPR sponsor, MassMutual, helping small businesses with long-term planning. Certified Exit Planning Advisor Brian Trzynski shares how they help business owners plan for the future of their business while they plan for retirement.
When a business owner wants to exit their business or leave it, our financial professionals can help them make sure that it's an actual transferable business that someone could purchase or somebody could take over and be able to run it successfully. But also, we want to make sure that they have the income in place, either from the sale of the business or from assets outside the business, that will allow them to continue the lifestyle that they become accustomed to. So our goal is to help business owners protect the business that they spent a lifetime building and actually be able to realize a comfortable and happy retirement.
To learn more, visit massmutual.com/businessowners.
This message comes from NPR sponsor MassMutual. Don't let the day-to-day of running your business keep you from planning for tomorrow. Start preparing for the future. Talk to a MassMutual financial professional today. Feel comfortable about tomorrow.
Our lives here in the U.S. are influenced by and inextricably intertwined with the history, politics, and cultures of countries like China, South Korea, and Taiwan.
Today, we continue our superpower series with the story of how the South Korean government's deliberate investment in sovereign power has completely remade global culture.
It was in 2019, like late 2019.
So I became a fan around 2015, 2016.
I would say it began in 2019.
it officially in 2016.
My roommate, actually, he showed me one music video, and then he showed me their performances on SNL. And for, like, weeks after, I just, like, could not stop watching those videos.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Please welcome.
Continue on I-275 South. Follow signs for Kentucky.
Every step of the way, there were sort of doubters and skeptics. Initially, they're like,
keep right at the fork to continue on I-275 South.
Well, Korean culture will be popular in Asia, but it will never be popular outside of this region.
Continue for 21 miles.
That it conquers Europe.
It conquers America.
And it finds the United States.
The country's pop culture exports have taken the world by storm, becoming a major contributor to South Korea's $1.6 trillion economy.
Now, Koreans themselves have become almost the kind of export, or even if they're not leaving, they become popular to people in other countries.
Korean pop culture has now become a really legitimized cultural force that rivals the U.S. How did they do it?
How did they do it?
How did Korean culture go global and take not just the world by surprise, but also Koreans themselves? I'm Renda Bittadeh.
And I'm Ramti Arapuri. On today's show, how a devastating war, nationwide economic collapse, and a deliberate government campaign gave rise to Hallyu, the Korean Wave.
Hi, this is Zach from Chesterfield, Michigan. We're listening to Throughline on NPR. Love you guys. Welcome to the world.
This message comes from Apple Card. Apple Card has a cash back rewards program unlike other credit cards. You earn unlimited daily cash on every purchase, receive it daily, and can grow it at 4.15 annual percentage yield when you open a savings account. Apply for Apple Card in the Wallet app on iPhone. Apple Card subject to credit approval. Savings is available to Apple Card owners subject to eligibility requirements. Savings accounts provided by Goldman Sachs Bank USA. Member FDIC. Terms apply.
Part 1. 고생 끝에 낙이 온다. At the end of hardship comes happiness.
Oh, so basically my family's never stopped talking about the Korean War. My name is Michael Kim. I am a Korean historian at the Yonsei University in Seoul, Korea. Well, yes, of course, growing up in the United States, I grew up watching maps. basically a show that depicts the life of a mobile army hospital.
I will take him second. What else you got?
This POW over here. He was in the back of the truck when it was hit.
And his chest is gone. Does he even have a pulse?
And so you're constantly getting a flood of soldiers that are wounded in the front, dying, being flown over by helicopters, and then the whole drama revolves around the lives of these nurses and officers, doctors, as they're treating these patients, but they don't know why they're there fighting this war, treating these people.
I forget the feeling there's a war going on.
There's always a war going on. War is the world's favorite spectator sport. These biscuits.
Well, everybody knows war is hell. Remember, you heard it here last.
War isn't hell. War is war and hell is hell. And of the two, war is a lot worse. What do you think of that?
And so they portray a kind of version of Korea, war-torn, devastated land and intense poverty everywhere. And of course, Americans being there trying to save these people.
Overhead, B-29's wing toward the Red Marshal Yards at Pyongyang to drop 100 tons of demolition bombs. The UN's answer is these day-in, day-out waves. The biggest of the war.
Around 12 o'clock, there was a bombing in the city. Since then, I haven't seen my brother. He went one way, and I went another.
There's almost no one killed on my father's side because he lives so far south. But on my mother's side, half the family was basically decimated. So, entire side of her family, over a dozen people were killed in just one bombing blast from American bomber. And then, of course, all their friends all went through very similar experiences. So yeah, for that generation, my parents' generation, the Korean War is still living in their minds.
In the U.S., the Korean War is also known as the Forgotten War. But for the Korean Peninsula, the three-year-long war was devastating. The U.S. dropped more bombs on North Korea than it dropped in the entire Pacific Theater during World War II.
Almost all of North Korea's flat.
And in the stories that Michael's parents told him and are still telling him, Michael also learned their attitudes towards Americans.
I don't think that on my mother's side, anyone ever thought that the Americans did it on purpose. So, for that generation, because of the context of the Korean War, even if there was all this violence in their family from the American side, they would still understand it as because it was necessary to fight off the North Koreans.
The Korean War was one of the first Cold War clashes between the U.S. and the Soviet Union. It was an ideological battle, communism versus democracy, North versus South. A battle that would never formally end, with two global superpowers backing opposite sides at the Korean people's expense.
Michael grew up understanding that Korean experience through America, but as an adult, he moved to South Korea to live.
Growing up as Asian American in the United States, you don't really necessarily understand your Korean or Asian people. So I think that's one of the reasons why I decided to research Korean history and then later return to Korea. Where then I start to encounter my Korean son.
And in his studies, Michael came to understand that the ambivalent relationship between the U.S. and South Korea...
Welcome to Indiana.
...didn't actually begin with the war. In fact, long before American boots touched Korean soil, American culture had already arrived.
Why haven't you come before?
I couldn't. I was afraid to.
But you could have written... It's been almost a year since you escaped.
It came with the Japanese occupation.
From 1910 to 1945, the Japanese Empire ruled the Korean Peninsula. The occupation was brutal. There were executions, forced labor, and near total repression of Korean culture. Koreans were forced to adopt and integrate Japanese culture into their lives.
So, if you're among the wealthiest and most educated Koreans, then I fought during colonialism, you would have an opportunity to attend Japanese universities and learn Japanese and become very much kind of Japanized in many ways. But then the typical Korean, they would still be living in their villages and hardly untouched, but completely untouched by what happens with the rest of Korea, in that they're still living in poverty, the farmers losing their jobs, and so there was quite a lot of economic disruption.
But the Japanese continued to industrialize the peninsula.
Because it was a colony, the Japanese actually invested considerably in the latest technologies, like the radio, the railroads, and so the infrastructure was laid down in a way that, of course, benefited the colonizers, but it could also be appropriated in ways that maybe nobody expected.
Like opening the door to American pop culture.
Well, you just caught me saying that Benny Singer was a good boy. Or just a good boy. Well, that's out of the door.
I'm sorry, I am.
Well,
you don't have to get to your mother.
Both Japan and Korea was also one of the largest markets of export for Hollywood. So in 1920s and 30s, it was not unusual for a Korean.
Welcome to Kentucky.
You had the means to watch a Hollywood film. And so if you read the magazines, they would be like a third of it would just be talking about Hollywood stars and the latest movies and trends. So Korea very early gets exposed to the global media scale.
When American soldiers replaced the Japanese as occupiers, they brought their own soft power in directly.
I'm an armed forces radio announcer, on the air with the news of the world as soon as it happens. Sports roundups, current events. There's music, lots of it, both popular and classic. All designed for one thing, to keep the serviceman informed. However, civilians find the programs of interest too, and often listen in.
AFKN, the military broadcast station, where you're constantly exposed to American TV and American radio because of the large troop presence in Korea.
There were many disillusioned by the conflict and uncertain in the future. Poverty and disease, the camp followers of war were everywhere.
We also have to think about how devastating the economy was in the 1950s, right after the war.
The Republic was a shambles. Property damage as a result of the communist invasion was so extensive, accurate estimations were impossible.
South Korea had been run into the ground. The land, carpet bombed, dust, and food was scarce. The economy was not existing. The government was stable. The country had one of the lowest per capita GDPs in the world. It was a precarious moment.
Then, 1961, a military coup. Park Chung-hee takes power.
And then he becomes an elected president.
Winner by a surprisingly narrow margin is General Chung-hee Park, who headed the junta. Whether its results will liberalize the government or continue a one-man rule, only Park can say.
The Korea of my parents was really what we call the Park Chung-hee era. President Park and the era of high-speed development.
Though some ancestors were aristocrats, Park was born into an impoverished rural family. He made his name in the military, where he served as a lieutenant for the Japanese during World War II, and then as a general in the Korean army. And once he took power, he ruled with an iron fist. Civil liberties and political freedoms were limited, and citizens were highly surveilled.
During the era of Park Chung-hee, people had curfews, you couldn't stay out at night, and people would go around measuring your hair. If it was too long, they would cut it, they would measure skirts. What that led to was the development of a night culture where, because you couldn't go home, people just stayed out all night. And so you would go to a bar and then you just stay there until the next morning because you couldn't be along the streets. And so So within these kinds of like speakeasies and bars, you had American rock music and all kinds of foreign influences. So there was a kind of a huge inflow of culture, both smuggled in as well as official, and then a kind of a space where people would enjoy themselves despite the military restrictions.
Still, daily life for many Koreans remained harsh. Park Jung-hee's goal was to transform Korea's economy, and to do that, he demanded self-sacrifice. He made this clear in a translated letter to the president of Seoul National University.
The survival of one generation is finite, but the country and its people's lives are eternal. Everything that our generation achieves through sweat today is not to live well today, but to pass it on to tomorrow's generation.
Koreans imagine themselves all to be of one country. There's a kind of idea that, well, you know, Korea is this kind of harmonious society, and everybody works hard, and they do everything they can for the nation.
Park hammered this message through culture and media. He censored content that didn't support his vision for Korea, and instead mandated that propaganda songs play at least twice a day on TV and radio, promoting hard work and patriotism.
And then he unleashed the economic miracle.
The message, the long hours, harsh working conditions, and low pay were all worth it, because it was all for the future of the free and independent South Korea. But for the citizens who were receiving this message, who'd been scarred from war and division and repression, nothing about this path was optional. There was no choice but to survive and toil on. When we come back, South Korea follows the road to prosperity and self-sufficiency.
In 2 miles, take exit 4 for Kentucky 212 toward TKY 20 Airport.
Lost.
Hi, I'm Lily. And I'm Rose, and we're calling from Oxford, England, that is, and you're listening to Throughline from NPR.
This message comes from NPR sponsor Tele.com. Top to bottom, front to back, and inside and out, every part of you is connected. So the way you care for your health should be too. That's why Teladoc Health provides connected care, bringing together virtual primary care, mental health support, and care for chronic conditions to help you get well and stay well, so you can live healthier ever after. Get started at teladochealth.com/freshair.
We just want to take a moment to shout out our Throughline Plus subscribers. Thank you so much for your support. If you don't already know, subscribing to Throughline Plus means you get to listen to our show without any sponsor breaks. And you also get access to special bonus episodes where we take you behind the scenes, introduce you to our amazing producers, and tell you about...
In half a mile, take exit 4 for Kentucky 212 toward TKY 20 Airport.
How we make the show. To get these awesome benefits and support our work here at NPR, head over to plus.npr.org/throughline.
Part 2. 호랑이의 출생. A tiger is born.
Take exit 4. In a quarter mile, sharp right onto Kentucky 212 West.
The Korean company Hyundai.
Sharp right onto Kentucky 212 West, then use the right lane to take the Donaldson Road ramp.
Called its first original car the Pony, perhaps a small nod to America's iconic Mustang. It made its international debut in 1974.
They call it the national car.
The Pony. Power and agility in a compact, superbly bred package.
It was the first Korean car on the global market.
the Hyundai Pony, built in the Far East using a lot of British machine tools and designed by an Italian, Giugiaro.
A car inspired by the world, but built by Koreans.
Wasn't necessarily the best car ever produced, but it was affordable for everyone.
It was a big success. For a while, it was actually the best-selling car in Canada. And even though its popularity waned, the Pony showed the world that Korea wanted to be and could be a major economic player.
Under Park Chung-hee, Korea underwent a massive transformation, but it started off slow.
You do get the investments in the beginnings of small first low-level industries.
That's John Nimoya, a history professor at Seoul National University.
Textiles, weirdly basic materials because they're building so much.
And then the Vietnam War happens. The U.S. still had troops on the ground in South Korea, and Park saw an opportunity. The war would bring billions into the country's economy.
Koreans make hundreds of millions of dollars doing the dirt, underground labor, and also supplying for the Vietnam War.
Because of the need to fight the Vietnam War and develop its allies, the United States then opens up its markets to Korean products.
The pace quickened.
Yeah, it's the Bali mentality, which is like faster, faster.
The investments in heavy chemicals, shipbuilding, steel mills, and so on.
Hello.
Good morning.
Morning.
Please insert credit card or tap advantage card.
And this one, make sure to use the same card when you get back.
It's checking card information.
I'll have you park on the left hand side
and you're following that.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. Have a good day.
You too.